Welcome to Faith Presbyterian Church on this Lord's Day morning to worship, to gather, and to give God our praises. If you are visiting us for the first time or it's been a long time, we want to welcome you heartily. We are very glad that you're here and honored and privileged that you chose to worship with us this morning. There are visitor welcome cards on the back of the pew in front of you. If you could fill it out so that we know you came, and put it in the offering basket that will come by later on in the service, that would be wonderful. So then we can know that you came, pray for you, and then respond with a card. You can also fill out our guest book right outside our center doors in the Narthex lobby. That'd be wonderful. Just a few announcements. We have the 27th Annual Joint Reformation Service coming up on October 27th at 5 p.m. This is a joint service of various Reformed and Presbyterian churches in our area. All the Presbyterian and Reformed churches and like-minded churches as well have been invited, and so it's usually a gathering of close to 400, 500 people. We really pack out our sanctuary with overflow, and it's a wonderful opportunity to worship with our fellow believers at least once a year. You get to see faces we haven't seen in a long time, to hear preachers we don't normally hear, and to sing together as one people. It's an opportunity for us to demonstrate the organic unity and oneness of the Universal Church. We have the great privilege of hearing the Reverend Dr. Joel Beakey. He is the president and professor at Puritan Reformed Theological Seminary in Grand Rapids. And what I really appreciate about him coming this year is not only is he a gifted and blessed preacher of the gospel, but he'll be considering the question, is the Reformed faith evangelistic? And I think he will do a very good job of demonstrating that the Reformed faith is the biblical faith that includes a hearty approach to evangelism and missions. That we ought to go out into all the world because of what we believe, and therefore share the gospel with the world. If you would remember the prayer and praise updates there for Jan Geckler and Barbara Keller. The harvest dinner is coming up. You can RSVP there with the website there. And so if you would quiet your hearts, let's let the anxieties and burdens of the past week fade in the background and fix our faith and our hope and our hearts upon the Lord. Let's take a moment of silence. Friends, brothers, and sisters, would you stand with me for the call to worship? This is when the Lord calls us with His word to enter into His presence, to worship Him by faith. The call to worship comes from Romans chapter 10, verse 13 and following. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then will they call on Him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in Him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. The Lord calls us into His presence by the word of Christ this morning as we pray together. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, we come to you this morning to hear the word of Christ. that it is through hearing that faith comes. Lord, would you give us faith? Would you strengthen our faith as we hear the Lord Jesus Christ call out to us in the gospel? Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that enables us and ushers us into your presence. Father, would you make us a spirit-enlightened, spirit-empowered people as we worship you this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now we will have our opening songs of praise on page 2 and 3 of the bulletin.
Praise under glory.
You may be seated. Now we come to confessing our faith together. If you would turn with me in your hymnals to page 845. This is a summary of what we believe the scriptures teach as the core and the center of our faith, the Apostles' Creed. And so let me begin. Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now the junior choir will bring us the anthem. Thank you. Thank you, children. Junior church is now dismissed. Well, now let's gather our hearts together and go to the Lord. He loves to hear our prayers and he wants to answer them. So let's come together as his people and make our petitions known to him as we pray together. Our Father, we come to you thankful for your mercies that are new every morning. Father, we thank you. Great is your faithfulness. Father, you alone are God of heaven and earth. And we're thankful that you have ordered the whole universe. You've hung every star, every sun, every moon. You have put them all in the right place, in the right orbits. You spoke the universe into being. You said, let there be, and it came about. Father, we thank you that you created the earth and all that is in it, the mountains, the oceans, the trees, the animals. Father, we thank you that you made everything good and beautiful in your creation, and you crowned it with your own glory when you made man and woman, when you made Adam and Eve out of the dust of the earth, and you breathed into us the breath of life, and we became living beings. Father, we thank you that you created us in your image to know your goodness, to have fellowship with you, to experience our joy and our happiness in union with you. But yet, Lord, Father, we confess that we have sinned and fallen short of your glory. We have not done those things which we ought to have done. We have left undone what we were supposed to have done. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We've sinned against not only your righteousness and your holiness, but we have sinned against your love and your grace, that you who would love us with such an infinite and deep love in the giving of your one and only Son, we have sinned against him. We've sinned against your love. Father, would you forgive us? Lord, would you help us? Would you win our hearts over with that love so that we would love you more than we would love our sin? That we would find our true joy and satisfaction in you, the eternal pleasure for which we were created to experience, rather than the fleeting, temporal pleasures of sin and of the riches of this world. They are but a drop in the bucket, and you are an infinite ocean of joy and peace. Father, would you help us then would you break us of our addictions to sin, our addictions to worshiping idols for that temporary pleasure, our addictions to self-satisfaction, self-righteousness, pride. Would you break us, Lord, of all of our sins of lying and cheating and stealing, coveting, lusting, committing adultery in our hearts, saying those things which we ought not to say, and not saying those things which we should say in order to love our neighbor as ourselves. Father, would you forgive us of all of those myriad of sins? And would you remind us that Jesus calls us to follow him, to find our joy and satisfaction in him. And so, Lord, that will keep us then from sinning against you. Lord, would you help us then to follow in your footsteps and to live in newness of life? Father, out of that grace, we're thankful for the forgiveness that you give to us. Lord, would you free us then to help our neighbor, to love our neighbor as ourselves, to worship you in freedom, in spirit, and in truth, that we would find our deepest joy in worshiping you this morning. Father, would you help us then to open your word and to read it, living as if, Lord, in the truth that we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from your mouth. Help us then to live in that practical reality, Lord, when our souls seem to be withering because we're not nourishing our souls with your word. And so we're giving in to every temptation. Lord, would you help us then to taste and see that you are good? Lord, would you make your word sweeter to our lips than honey? That your word would be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. That it would answer our deepest questions and satisfy our deepest needs as they speak of who you are to us. Father, we pray for our families, our marriages, that you would keep them strong, that they would reflect the grace of your gospel. Would you help our husbands to lead as Jesus leads us as a church? Would you help us to love as Jesus loved us and laid down his life for us, for our nourishment, for our sanctification, for our lives? Father, would you help our wives, Lord, to submit as unto Jesus. Lord, would you shape our hearts in such a way that as we trust the Lord, you would help our wives to follow, Lord, us as we follow together the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you also bless the raising of our children, our covenant children, Lord, though they have been baptized into this family. Lord, help us not to take for granted that they too need to repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ for themselves. Lord, help us not to nurture a pharisaical faith, a faith in which we take for granted repentance and being born again. Father, would you cause each and every one of our covenant children to lay hold and to hold on to Jesus by faith for themselves and not to have a secondhand faith. Lord, give them all the resources that they need so that they might grow more and more in Christ. And Father, we look forward to hearing and seeing all of our young people thrive in Jesus Christ through faith in the gospel. Father, would you bless all of our ministries from the greatest to the least, from the youth group, from Sunday school, from the community groups, Lord, from our midweek studies, our Bible Bistro, our men's community group, our women's community groups. Father, Lord, help us to be a community that rallies around your word as the source of life and of light, that it would reflect what we really believe of how we ought to live as a community, that we would be people of the word as a community of the word who live by the word. Father, would you bless those who are sick and ill among us? Lord, would you help those who are fighting infections and chronic ailments? Would you heal them and help them? We pray also, Father, for those who are acutely sick. Would you help them, Lord? Heal them. Give them strength. Help them persevere. And Father, we pray for those who are homebound, Lord. As they are home and feeling lonely and left out, Lord, would you remind them that you will never leave them nor forsake them, but you will always be with them to the very end of the age, and that you would use us to come alongside them, to minister to them, to be companions and to keep them company and to love them. Help us then not to forget those who we do not see, but to make a concerted and intentional effort to be with them in their times of need. Father, as we continue on in the service, Lord, would you receive our tithes and offerings as we give them cheerfully unto you, that you would use them for the greater glory and expansion of your kingdom and the glory of your Son. Would you bless us this morning? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The ushers may now take the morning offering. Would you open your hymnals with me? We sing a hymn of thanksgiving. If you would turn with me to number 176, Hail Thou Once Despised Jesus. If you'd stand with me, if you're able, number 176. Well, we come now to the reading and preaching of God's Word. If you would open your Bibles with me, we continue. We are now at the fifth message of our short series through the servant songs of Isaiah. We are at the second message here in chapter 53. If you'd turn with me and I will read the first 12 verses, but this morning's sermon will concentrate particularly on the first three verses of chapter 53. We're going to look at the nature of the suffering servant's mission and how it's going to shape his life, shape who he is, and what he's going to do for us in the gospel. But before we do that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's ask him for his help. Let's pray together. Our Father, we come to you confessing that apart from your grace, who would believe your message? Apart from your word, apart from your power of grace in our lives, we cannot hear. We have no ears. We're blind, deaf, and dumb to the grace of your word. But Lord, would you empower your Holy Spirit to make effective that word so that we would indeed have eyes to see and ears to hear and lips to sing your praises as we hear your word read, and particularly as we hear it preached. Father, would you be with me as I read it and proclaim it? Would you give me your Holy Spirit so that your people would hear your voice, that I would decrease and Jesus would increase? In his name we pray, amen. If you have a different Bible, you can follow along as well on page 4 if you don't have a Bible either. So, hear now the reading of God's word beginning in verse 1 of chapter 53. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous. And he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the many. And he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. May he add the blessing to his word. You know, in 1974, Francis Schaeffer published a sermon entitled The Lord's Work in the Lord's Way. In it, he highlights the various dangers to the gospel and to Christianity, not only from without, but also from within. Not only the forces out, you know, in the world that are against the gospel and of the Church of Jesus Christ. But he also highlights the dangers, the more hidden dangers, the more subtle dangers, those dangers from within that are more likely to undo the gospel and his church. Let me quote a little section of his sermon. And he says this about the central problem of the age. He says, the central problem of our age is not liberalism or modernism, nor the old Roman Catholicism or the new Roman Catholicism, nor the threat of communism, nor even the threat of rationalism and the monolithic consensus which surrounds us. All these are dangerous, but not the primary threat. The real problem is this: the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ, individually or corporately, tending to do the Lord's work in the power of the flesh rather than of the Spirit. The central problem is always in the midst of the people of God, not in the circumstances surrounding them. In other words, what he's saying is that our biggest problem, the biggest danger to the gospel and of the Church of Jesus Christ is that when we try to do the Lord's work in the world's way, adopting worldly methods when God calls us to do it His way. And it is a way that goes counter to the ways of the world. This is why Paul in 1 Corinthians makes a distinction that the wisdom of God is foolishness to those who are perishing. It is foolishness to everyone else who has a completely different worldview in which God plays no meaningful part. And that's why then the foolishness of God's way is not wisdom to the world. And it's because we try to do the Lord's work in the world's way. And so when we look, and the reason for this is when we look down on the Lord's way, a way of grace, a way of humility, a way that inspires faith and not works, not by grace and not by power or human achievement, a way of humility and not exaltation, a way of weakness and not of power. It's when we reject that way of grace and adopt a way of worldly wisdom and success is when we reject the gospel in principle. At the heart of it all, we reject God's grace. We reject God's message. We reject God's message in the gospel because we reject God's man in the gospel. And that's what we see here this morning. That's what we're going to look at this morning in Isaiah's prophecy. It is going to be a message of rejection that brings us a message of redemption. A man of sorrows who will become a man of salvation in the gospel. So let's look at what that means, right? I'm going to have three headings for this morning's sermon. A rejected message, a rejected man, and a rejected life that leads to redemption and salvation. So first, let's look at how this message is going to be rejected. The gospel is a message that's going to be rejected because it goes against all human wisdom, and that only God can turn this message into a message of redemption. Last week, we had a preview of this way of grace, right? This upside-down way of grace. When the servant of the Lord suffers, he suffers in order to save those for whom he will die. In order to save people, he has to be humbled in order to be exalted. And when it's done, the message of his salvation will go out into all the nations. He will sprinkle the nations. And to those who have not seen, they will hear. To those who do not know, they will understand. He says there in verse 15 of chapter 52. Now, it is this message that has gone out, that's going to go out of this kind of upside-down message of grace. We hear the response of those who are sent to preach the gospel. Right? In other words, when God tells us to go and preach the gospel to all the nations, you know, this is the first response for those who hear the message but wondering, you know, how it's going to be received when they go and preach it. And what's going to happen is they are going to wonder, you know, are people going to believe it, right? Look at verse 1. We hear the response of those who preach it, and we hear their inner skepticism at how they think it's going to be received. And the way that they respond is that they know in some way it's going to be a rejected message, right? Speaking in the prophetic past tense, right? This is how Isaiah works. This is how a lot of the prophets work in the Old Testament, that they think of, they speak about something future, but it is so certain that it's going to happen that they speak about it in the past tense. That's the way God's prophetic past tense works. It's a little, it seems paradigmatic, but paradoxical, excuse me, but it's so certain that it's going to happen that they speak in the past tense. And so the prophets who are charged with going out into the world to preach the good news of this suffering servant, they respond, "Who has believed what they heard from us?" They know that this is a message that is not going to go over well with the masses. It's a message that goes counter to everything that they know and believe. You can hear the incredulity and the skepticism in the very question itself. You can hear the difficulty of preaching a message that a man who suffers so horrifically, so grotesquely, so gruesomely that people don't even recognize that he's a man. People turn their faces and close their mouths because they're in such horror at him being beaten and tortured and bloodied. This man is going to be high and lifted up, not only on the cross, but after his death and resurrection, he is going to be high and lifted up and ascended and seated at God's right hand. And the prophets are wondering, Lord, are people going to believe this? That a person is going to suffer horrifically and then be seated at your right hand? He is going to be humbled in order to be exalted. He's going to die and rise again in order to give life to others. It goes completely against human nature, right? The wisdom of the world is that in order to ascend, you have to ascend with cunningness, with power, with ingenuity, with achievement, right? You have to work in order to make it up the ladder. And so it goes counter to what people believe. And so who's going to believe it? That is the question that the prophets are asking. Isn't that a question that we ask ourselves? I don't know about you, but you know, I know when I first believed, I was very skeptical. When I first became a Christian, I was like, that's unbelievable. You know, that a God would become man, he would be raised in an impoverished town with regular parents, that he would come and he would save people from their sins. He would do miracles. He was even raised the dead to life, and he would bear our sins and die in our place and be to rise again after 3 days to save people. And we can only be saved if we believe in that. I was a little skeptical at first, not a little, a lot. It was an unbelievable message, but, and we're going to get to this in a moment, it became not skeptically unbelievable, but it became a faith-empowering unbelievable. It became a message to me at some point that it was so unbelievable that it had to be true. No one can make this stuff up. I don't know if you've ever listened to Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me on NPR. I think I'm revealing too much about myself, but it's a little radio variety show, and they have guests who come in and they ask questions about current events. And what they'll do is they'll ask their host, their guest, and they'll give four bylines, four titles of stories that were in the news. And one of them is true, right? And they give three that are false and one that is true, but they're all unbelievable on the first hearing. And I think the secret, and this is just me when I listen to it, the secret to winning, getting the right answer for that particular game is choosing the one that is the most unbelievable, and therefore it is true. And the gospel is very much like that. It's the one that no one else could have made up, and it had to have happened, and therefore it has to be true. So let's move on here. Not only is it a rejected message, but it's going to be a rejected message that has to be revealed in order to be received. The second part of verse 1, he says, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Now, this is the language of redemption. Whenever God saves his people from slavery in Egypt or from their enemies, foreign invading armies, God describes his rescue of them by saving them with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. The picture here is of Israel drowning in the ocean and God just, anthropomorphically, kind of just in the language that we can understand, God literally reaching down from heaven, grabbing Israel as a nation, picking them up out of their drowning water, and putting them on dry land. It is that illustration, that imagery of salvation that Isaiah is using here. Right? And to whom has the arm of the Lord then been revealed? And what he's saying there is that this message, this unbelievable message, it's almost like God is going to pick them up and reveal it to them, and then they will hear and believe. But apart from God's arm picking them up in order for them to believe, they won't believe it. So this rejected message, although lots of people are going to reject it, and we know this from our own experience, God will reveal it to those whom he wants to reveal it to. And in doing so, he saves them. And that's the whole point of verse 1. No matter how unbelievable, no matter how unpopular, no matter how hard it may seem on our part for people to believe this seemingly unbelievable, far-fetched story, true story of the gospel, with us it will be impossible for people to believe. But with God, all things are possible. Amen? That nothing is impossible with God. And here's how. This means two things for you and for me. If it's a message that only God can reveal to a person, then what that means for you and for me is we need to share it by faith. We need to share it by faith. It's not up to us to make the gospel as believable as we can with smart arguments and logic and powerful persuasion, although that's not a bad thing, right? We shouldn't not want to be helpful and winsome and really persuade people, but that is not what is going to make them believe. I remember growing up in a church where the whole responsibility lies upon the one who shares. That if you make the right arguments, if you make the right persuasive logic, you give the right evidence, then that person should believe. But if you don't, they won't believe. And so I felt so much guilt because I would share the gospel and give all of these really cool answers to every question. And I would put the full force of my intellect and my faith into sharing the gospel and with these people, and they didn't come to faith. And it was my fault. I felt like I'm the one who's responsible for converting these people. And so, but that's not the way grace works. It is not by human wisdom or powerful rhetoric or persuasion. It is simply by the power of God to reveal the arm of his salvation to that person through the sharing of the gospel. And so it may seem from our perspective, unbelievable. But God can make the impossible possible. And that's where faith comes in. And we ought to do the best to share the gospel and to give good answers to their questions and their skeptical perspectives. But at the end of the day, leave it up to the Lord. Ask God to reveal it to them. Ask God to cause them to be born again so that they would actually hear with spiritual ears and see with spiritual eyes. And if they don't believe, it doesn't mean that you failed. It means that maybe you've sown a seed that God is going to raise up at some future point. I think I heard the gospel probably, hundreds of times before I became a Christian. And I'm sure the same goes for you. But somebody sowed a seed, and somebody else watered it, and God gave the increase to where you were born again, and you put your faith in Christ. And so salvation, again, we begin to see the Lord's work has to be done in the Lord's way, by faith, by grace, not by human ingenuity or arguments. And so God calls us then to share the gospel far and wide with everyone near and far, family, friends, neighbors, across the ocean, across the street. If we share it by faith and we leave it up to God, God will always glorify himself. Even though we think it's unbelievable, God will make it completely believable. He will open their eyes to see the truth. And so it's incumbent upon us not to lose faith and say, oh, they'll never believe, so I won't share. Right? Their hearts are so hard that I know they're going to reject it, so I just won't bring it up. Who has believed what they heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? To everyone you share the gospel with. And secondly, the only way someone can ever come to come to faith is if they hear the gospel from us. And so the Lord uses means. Paul puts it this way, and here, this is the way that the New Testament interprets verse 1 here. That it's in terms of sharing the gospel with everyone and letting God do everything else. He says this in chapter 10, verse 13, "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. But how are they to call on him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel," Isaiah says. "Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us?" And so faith comes from hearing, and hearing from the word of Christ. You know what? The one thing we know for sure that people will not come to faith in Christ is if we do not tell them. And so we ought to be prepared for people to reject the gospel, and that's at that moment, and that's okay. But we've done our part, and God will glorify himself, and he will do his. And the most beautiful picture that I think I have of this this dynamic is that when we preach the gospel to people who really can't hear it because of whatever obstacles they have in their own hearts, whatever spiritual deadness they have. They can't really hear the spiritual things that can give life. They're deaf to the gospel, right? And this is one of the ways that God's arm of salvation reveals things to people, by giving them ears to hear. And the best picture, I think, of this is when I've seen this video, these videos of deaf children who've never heard their parents' voice, finally get an implant, and the ear doctor finally turns on their hearing aid, and then mom and dad call out to the little baby, "Hello, hi," and you can hear the baby or the child's face light up. For the first time, they've heard their parents' voices calling out their name. And that's the way it is with God in the gospel for those sinners to whom we share the gospel with. That God, at that moment when we share it with them, God is putting in his divine hearing aid so that they can finally hear the voice of their heavenly Father calling them, inviting them to put their faith in Jesus Christ for the very first time, because they can actually hear his voice. And God can use us to do that if we will share it with them. Let's move on. Secondly, the gospel is not only a rejected message, But it is a rejected message because it is about a rejected man. And this is what we see here. A man rejected for who he is and what he has come to do. Where he's from. He will be from a rejected place. Look at what he says there. For he grew up before him like a young plant, like a root out of dry ground, right? This dry ground has this idea of no man's land, a desert. And a shoot is shooting up out of this dry land. And the metaphor here is that he's going to come from a nowhere town, a podunk place, an out-of-the-way backwater that everyone is not going to expect somebody important to ever come from. And it reminds us of all the prophets who come. You know, Bethlehem is an important city, but it wasn't important until David became king, who was chosen because he came from Bethlehem. And Jesus, who was born in Bethlehem as a son of David, wasn't raised there. His real place, hometown, was Nazareth. It was in Galilee, no man's territory. Think of it as the middle of the Nevada, some little town in the middle of the Nevada desert, with a population of 100, and that's it. You know, one stoplight, let alone an intersection. And that's why when he was walked the earth and performed miracles and taught from God's word, people asked, can anything good come from Nazareth? You know? And so he's going to come from a rejected place, a nowhere place. He will also have a rejected, unattractive appearance. Right? Look at the rest of verse 2 there. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him. No beauty that we should desire him. When you think of Jesus, what do you think he would have looked like? Right? He would have been absolutely unassuming and unattractive. A plain, average Joe. A face that can get easily lost in a crowd. Right? He wouldn't have been an influencer on Instagram. He would have been the last and the least on our list of attractive and charismatic people, let alone a leader, let alone a Messiah or a Savior of Israel. There's nothing, absolutely nothing about him that would have made us look at him and say, well, that man has potential. Right? He's going to be somebody important someday. He is going to be a leader. No, we would have looked at him and said, he's just plain and simple, nothing to write home about, just meh. And yet, he is going to turn the world upside down. You know, this reminds me of the Lord of the Rings trilogy, where the heroes of the whole trilogy, the whole story, it's not the warriors. They're part of the heroic thrust of the Lord of the Rings. They're not the true heroes of the trilogy. Is not the armies, the horse lords, the kings, the warriors, or the wizards, but the little unassuming hobbits. They are the smallest of the people of Middle Earth. You don't expect them to deal any blows, let alone the death blow against Sauron. But at the end, it's their lack of majesty or beauty, their lack of power and prowess that wins the day. And they are able to destroy the Ring of Power and destroy the power of Sauron. And it was precisely because they were the littlest, the weakest of Middle Earth. And at the end, I really love, in the movies at least, how the whole kingdom bows, even the king bows to the hobbits, because the weakest were used in such a way that they were the most powerful. And that's the way the Messiah will come. That's the way Jesus will save his people, that the rejected man will be the man who redeems sinners. He will be rejected by everyone around him. He was despised and rejected by men. He's going to be hated by those, rejected by those who knew him, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. As one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Like all the prophets, like all the servants of the Lord, they were rejected and despised. From Abraham to Joshua, from Moses to David, and all the prophets, including Isaiah himself. But ultimately, this will be fulfilled in the rejection of the man of sorrows, the man of grief, in the coming of the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, the suffering servant of the Lord. This whole passage is going to point us to him and be fulfilled in him, that he will be the man of rejection who will bear the life of rejection that leads to the suffering and death of rejection for our sins on the cross. Here's the reason why he was rejected. Here's the reason why he was despised and we esteemed him not. This is why he's going to be suffering and tortured and crucified on a cross. Not because he deserved rejection, because he bore our sins and we deserved rejection. He received the rejection of sinners by taking the rejection of our humanity, of our fallenness in his own body. He became one of us, stricken, smitten, and afflicted by God, so that we might be received, redeemed, and reconciled by a holy and gracious God. He took the rejection that we deserve for our sins, crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you rejected me? So that we then, by faith, might receive his righteousness, be received by him and reconciled to him in the gospel. This is the gospel of his rejection that becomes for us our reception and redemption with God. And all of this comes by faith in the message, the man, and the life of the gospel in Jesus Christ. And so this morning I want to invite you not to reject the message, but to receive it by faith. That God would reveal it to you. He would give you ears to hear right now, a new heart to believe right now, if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, in this rejected man, in this despised, hated, unesteemed, unassuming, unattractive man who died on the cross in your place, so that you might be completely and fully received with arms wide open to the love of God the Father. And now God calls out your name. Would you come to me? Would you hear my voice as I reveal my salvation to you? And for those who believe in him, what this means for us is that we too are going to be rejected, just like he was. We're going to be despised and hated just like he was. We are going to be people of sorrow and acquainted with grief, as those from whom people will turn their faces away, despised, and they will esteem us not. Though we may experience it all, Jesus knows our sorrows. This is why I became a Christian, because there is a God who is in heaven, almighty, all-powerful, all-knowing over all. But yet he deigns to condescend and lower himself down, to take upon himself our weak and frail humanity, to suffer, to be rejected, to be despised, so that we might not only be received by God, but that he would give the resources of his own experience to you and to me. And he would comfort us to say, I know your sorrow. Only the God of Christianity, only Jesus, who is both God and man, can say to us as God and man to say, I know your sorrow and I will walk with you. In the valley of the shadow of death, I will be with you. And we will walk through this dark valley of despair and suffering together. How do we know that? After 3 days, I rose from the grave. ascended, and I am seated in glory right now, and you will be with me as well. Do you believe that? And all of that is because Jesus was rejected so that you and I might be received. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you for being the man of sorrows, who helps us in our sorrows, who is rejected by everyone so that we might be received. Father, would you help us to see this truth so then, Lord, that we might then live by this grace, by this truth in your way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, brothers and sisters, friends, would you open your hymnals with me? We have our closing hymn of response and of praise. If you would turn with me in your hymnals to number 246. Man of Sorrows, what a name. If you're able, please stand, and we'll sing the last hymn a cappella. To those who know the man of sorrows, who helps you in your sorrows, hear now his benediction to you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And all of God's people said,
Amen.